Motion tracking is a really fun and powerful and just awesome effect to use in your videos, and fortunately in recent years it's become easier and easier to use. So today I'd like to introduce you to how I use motion tracking in my video intros. And what you saw just right there was an example of what I'm talking about, and it's something that I've been doing for a little bit over a year now, the specific motion tracking thing. You can see all these examples right here. Basically, what I try to do in an intro to a video is have an interesting looking shot. Usually it involves the product or whatever I might be talking about in that video, and then I find a place to put my little animated logo in it, where the logo, even though it's a digital thing that's added to a real life video clip, I want to make it look like it actually exists there in real life, like it's really part of the object and it's kind of, you know, pinned there for real and the camera's actually, you know, moving around it. And I do this with a plugin for Final Cut Pro from Motion VFX called M Tracker 3D. This video is not sponsored, I've just been using it for a long time. Like I said, I think it's been about 100 projects at this point that I've used some type of Motion VFX tracking on. And I really like it, and I think I have a pretty good handle on it, so I just want to share that with you. And you can take this idea and use it for things beyond video intros. I like using it when I need to label things in a scene to make it more clear. Like here, for example, I have two cameras that look very similar, but I was able to use the tracker to label both of them, and the title stay with the correct camera, even though the camera filming them is moving around the shot. So point being, I'll show you one way to do it, but then you can use your creativity and your imagination to let the sky be the limit. The plugin itself is pretty easy to install. I've always kind of struggled with Final Cut plugins in the past, but once you download it, you also get like this application, which is sort of a plugin manager on your computer. And from there, you can just install or uninstall this plugin or any other Motion VFX plugins that you might have also. So now let's get started with an example in Final Cut Pro. I'll recreate what I would normally do for a video intro. And to do that, I've actually taken an intro from a previous video. This is my video about the Sony FX3 cage. I'm wearing the exact same shirt. Continuity, even though this was like weeks ago. So the role of the intro, beyond just having fun motion tracking, is to sort of be a punctuation mark, for me at least. In my intro, I try to explain what the video is going to be about, and also try to include some sort of goofy joke or wordplay. Sometimes it's good, and most of the time it's not that good. And then the intro happens, and then the actual video starts. And the intro is really short. It's literally like 3 seconds long. Basically, I've got these two clips here. This would be the intro, and then this would be the part that comes after the intro. I've now had my Sony FX3 for just about a year, and for the past 7 months, I've had a cage for it. So despite all my rage, it's still just a cam in a cage. That is a really dumb joke that was supposed to be a Smashing Pumpkins reference. So when I'm editing the rough cut of a video, what I'll do is, where I know the intro is going to go, I will go into my generators in Final Cut Pro and take a custom generator and just put that here and just sort of shorten the length a little bit. And that just tells me, come back here later and add in the intro. And that also separates the intro from the start of the video. So we have the joke, still just a cam in a cage. And then there'll be the intro, which will probably be more about like that long. And then we come back, even though it's called me talking about whatever the subject of that video is. So before adding in the clip that I'm going to work with, I actually add in the animated intro, the thing that I want to track. In this case, the animated logo is something that I just made in Procreate on the iPad. You can do all kinds of like fun animation stuff there. And this is that video file. So I'll extend the generator. I go to the very last frame of this animation, shorten it up there. And now the animation is that long. And then I take the generator I made and make it the exact same length as my animation, and then delete the animation. The reason I like to do this is because now I know whatever clip I end up using is going to be the exact right length to match the logo. So now I just need to find a clip. Usually this is a B-roll shot that I've filmed while recording the video. In this case, I just took a few other examples from other videos. Here's one of a microphone, my Sennheiser MKH50, and here's one of a red cinema camera sensor. What I look for in a good clip is that there's a dominant subject, it's usually the subject of the video, and that there's some camera movement. So this one is great because there's a lot of contrast between the microphone and the background, and the microphone also has really clear lines, which will make it easy to track and also easy to kind of align and adjust the logo with. The camera sensor would be fun too, but I think the mic is gonna be more fun, so we'll just do that. This clip is way longer than I need it to be. So I just find a part that I think will look good, kind of like this part here. It's not really super scientific. And then I just shorten that there. It's at this point that I'll add any color correction or effects to that clip. So I have a little preset that I had made to just sort of pop the colors a little bit. The one thing not to do is to add stabilization in Final Cut Pro. I do add a lot of stabilization normally to my B-roll clips, but not on the intro because the Final Cut stabilizer and the motion VFX tracker will start to fight each other a little bit and you might not get the best results. So I don't use stabilization on here. If I did want this clip to be longer, like to start here and then have the logo come in later, I'll just cut the clip here and then I'll only track this part and not this part. So basically the intro is going to look something like this. Still just a cam in a cage. Then there'll be the logo. Even though it's... And then it comes back to me talking. I did like, intentionally, I left this little awkward sound of the camera cage clicking. Because this is such a bad joke, the dead silence with no music is something that I think helped. Just a cam in a cage. And the awkward clanky sound from the camera cage, I think is a fun punctuation mark. I do like to use sort of a J cut in this situation. So if you didn't know this, in Final Cut Pro, when you have a clip with audio, you can double click on the audio and it will break those apart, but it's not actually detaching the audio. And so I'm going to select the edge of the video and then just press the comma key a few times to nudge it over. And now you'll see the audio is going to start while the shot of the intro is still playing.
Even though it's called a full...
There we go. So in the case of this actual video, I didn't have any music in the intro because the silent awkwardness was funnier to me. But normally I do have music, at least in the intros of my videos. So we'll use this song as an example. I'll take that and turn it way, way down to like negative 27 decibels. I've now had my Sony FX3 for just about a year, and for the past, the song's playing really quietly in the background. And then when the intro starts, what I could even do here is when I make the bad joke, stop the music, just a cam in a cage, and then have it kick back in here. There, I think that's a cool, yeah. A cage.
Even though...
And then what I'll do is I'll lower this volume down to where I'd want it to be.
Even though it's called a full...
While I'm talking, I would want that to be really quiet. Normally I would have this like fade out to and go away. But during the intro, I'm gonna press R and use the range key to select that. And then I'm going to bring this up a little bit louder, usually to like negative 14 or so. I want the music during the intro to be louder, but not too loud. And then I want it to fade down when I start talking again.
Even though it's called a full
stage, it actually... So that's how I would add in audio. And now we can get to the tracking. Don't worry, I haven't lost track of what this video is about. Basically, once you install the M-Tracker 3D plugin, when you click on your effects panel and you scroll down, you'll see it right there, M-Tracker 3D. And then you just take that and drag that on top of your clip. And then you'll get this little window up here in the inspector. You have a few options, it says free and show hints. Hints are kind of nice. It's the stuff that's on screen that tells you what you're doing and how to do it. Even though I've been using it forever, I leave it. Generally, you can just click track and then you just wait for it to track. How long this takes is gonna depend on how long your clip is and also how complex the movement and the tracking needs to be. So in this case, it was successful and I can just click now on copy track and now it has copied all that tracking information. Sometimes you might get an error that says it was unable to track, and if that happens, all you need to do is change movement from free to tripod. It probably just means there wasn't quite enough movement among all the different axes to track effectively. And if you click it to tripod mode, it sort of reduces that and does a more simple track. And then it usually works really well. But I try to start with the free track because that gives you the most info and the most dynamic tracking. Now that we've got our track, the thing to do is to go into the titles in Final Cut Pro, and you'll see you're going to have an M-Tracker 3D title along with anything else. I have a lot of other motion VFX stuff, so those are here, but here's M-Tracker 3D. There's all kinds of different ones if you just want to do titles, whatever. But since I'm adding in an existing animated clip, a logo, I'm going to go down here to Drop Zone Basic. And I'm just going to bring this down here, and it's just going to look like a normal Final Cut Pro title. And then I'll just shorten this up to the length of the clip, click on that, go over to the title section. Instead of the normal text thing that I would see in a title, we're gonna see the M-Tracker stuff, and I'm going to paste the track. And it'll say tracking saved successfully. And now if I play through this, You'll see it's kind of moving a little bit. It doesn't look perfect and the scale's all weird and my logo's not there, but we'll get to all of that. The first thing that I then like to do is click this little crosshair, and then this is where you can click on what you actually want your tracking point to be. So you can click on anything in your scene, and because we were using that free tracking, it actually transforms your object to whatever would make sense based on like the coordinates of that specific point in the frame. If you don't want to throw around all these weird angles and things, you can just hold down shift, and then you can see the little, like, the thing that I'm dragging around that's going in all these different directions. If I press shift, now it just stays, you know, vertical and horizontal. And so I just want to track the microphone, so I'm just going to click on a part of the microphone, and I might need to click a couple of times until I find something that looks really solid. In this case, the white of the Sennheiser logo on the black of the microphone was a good thing to track. It's a very clear point that's easy to follow. And now when I play back, you can see the little box stays pretty solidly on the microphone. Now we can adjust things. If we scroll down here, you have all kinds of options for whatever you have just dropped in there. This menu is going to change depending on which kind of tracker you're using, but this is what the basic drop zone looks like. So the first thing I'll usually do is kind of scale it up just a little bit. And then we can actually add in our media. So just click this little import icon here and you'll get this window where you can select your media. Since I already added my logo to the timeline earlier to get the length of the clip correct, it's already in my media library. So I just edge over to the very first frame and then click apply clip. And now I've got my logo in the scene and the timing should match up perfectly. Except the problem is logo's too small and there's a giant black box around it. So let's take care of those things. The reason I have the logo on a black background is because you can go change the drop zone blend mode from normal to add, and then it will get rid of that almost like chroma keying it out. And now I just have my logo floating. It's way too small to even read, so I'm going to scale it up. You can use these content position, rotation, and scale options to change things. There are even keyframes, but I don't usually go that crazy with it. So I'm gonna scale this up a little bit, or a lot of bit, I guess. And then I'm gonna change the positions to where I would want it. Normally I would probably do something kind of like this, where it's right on the edge of the microphone. That actually looks pretty decent. If I want to go a little bit further and make things a little more special, then I'll sometimes play with the rotation. Because if we look here, the microphone and the edge of the logo aren't perfectly parallel to each other, so I could try to play with this rotation just a little bit. Like negative 0.5 maybe, and then I can put it over there. I found that by tilting things or moving things a little bit so that they don't look so perfect, then it looks more like an object in the scene and less like a graphic that's just been pasted on top of something. You could even go crazy and do like a 90 degree transformation and then move this over so now we can make it look like the logo is sitting on the side of the microphone here, something like that. Now, like I said, you do have more options. If you're changing the drop zone settings, this is the actual whole thing that you have. It's like the box that you have placed that you're adding your content to. If you're just changing the content, that is the clip or the media. This could be a still image, whatever you've added to that, that's what you're adjusting there. So the drop zone itself, you can change, you know, the opacity of that. We change the blend mode. We can change the scale of the whole thing. We can also move that around a little bit. You even have some blending options like noise and blur. You can go in and play with colorization and shadow. So this gets really powerful and pretty impressive depending on what you need to make. But in general, I'm just either working with clear PNG images or an animated logo on a black background. Now, if I did want to add something else to this same shot, like in the example I showed earlier with the two cameras and there were two different things being tracked, we wouldn't want to do it with the same thing. So we would actually add in another drop zone or another title if we wanted to. But if you wanted to add another one, you would just click on your main clip, copy the tracking info, and then just paste that tracking info over there again. And what you don't want to do is then start moving things around and shifting these around or cutting your clip, because basically what you're doing is you're altering all the tracking info and then you might find stuff isn't matching up the way that you want to. So that's why I take the time to make sure everything is timed perfectly and positioned perfectly before I start adding the tracking to it. I know that's a lot to keep track of, but you don't want to cause commotion with motion VFX. So to add a second thing, I'm just going to drag this robot down here, extend it over to the same length, go to my main clip, copy the tracking info, and then just paste that tracking info back to the robot, and now I have him also being tracked here. This looks so stupid. And we'll just position him. So now we've got two items in our intro. We have my logo and the walking robot. So we've got these two items right here. So again, my goal here isn't to show you every possibility and every nuanced feature of this, but just to show you how I use the Motion VFX M-Tracker 3D to create my video intros. Final Cut Pro does now have its own built-in tracker, which is really, really cool. But the reason I use this extra paid plugin instead of the free built-in tracker with Final Cut is because it is significantly more fully featured and has a lot more flexibility. The Final Cut Pro 1 can be excellent, and I'm sure it's only going to continue to get better over time. But this has been around for a number of years already, so it's pretty fully developed and pretty fleshed out, and it works really, really well. And because of that, it's become a really great way to add a pop of style to my videos, along with a fun, creative challenge in every video that I make. And speaking of things that are fun and creative, thank you to everyone who helps support my channel through Patreon and YouTube channel memberships. And if you're looking for a few more ways to help progress your Final Cut Pro skill set, check out these videos right here.